Kochani, zaczynamy kolejny dzień.
We are starting a new day. And this is about celebrating mercy in everyday life. So we have talked about God's mercy in the Holy Sacraments, in God's words. We've been trying to learn how to celebrate it in everyday life. Where to look for strength and where to look for mercy. Today, God tells us that He is sending us. We have this beautiful reading from Jonah, how Jonah was fighting against accepting God's mission. And Faustina tried to escape, run away as well, but God found her. So we also have a mission as apostles of divine mercy. So today we will also talk about spreading the message, taking it to the world. So we are going to talk about creativity in charity in life of Saint Faustina and the apostles of divine mercy. It is going to be given by Sister Emanuela Gemza.
Niech będzie pochwalony Jezus Chrystus. Skoro Duch Święty już przyszedł, to możemy zaczynać.
When we're sure that the Holy Spirit came, we can start. In the beginning, I would like to invite you to close your eyes and imagine some beautiful place you would like to be at. Maybe the beach, maybe some mountain route, maybe some desert island. Try to imagine this place and feel the smell of the place. Okay, let us now come back to the reality of Krakow, Łagiewniki, with the same good feeling we had in our images. So this was a good use of our imagination. That is the gift of God. Sometimes we say that people have
to jest coś, co może nam bardzo pomóc.
Imagination. It can help us in our creativity, but it can also make our life difficult. Saint Teresa of Avila, in relation to the spiritual life, to prayer, she said that the imagination is like an old mad woman in the house. But it's not about our mere human imagination we're going to talk about today, but about the imagination of mercy. This term was first used by Saint John Paul II in the apostolic letter Novo Millennio in Unta. In this document, the Pope first writes that on the threshold of the new millennium, he sees an extremely advanced economic, technical, and economic development, and at the same time, enormous poverty, injustice, and social exclusion of many people. He also sees those who lack nothing in material terms and yet experience more and more often the meaningless life, the despair, the loneliness, drug addiction, and other kinds of enslavement. Saint John Paul II opens a new horizon for us in these words. Well, he writes, "Now is the time for a new creativity in charity, not only by ensuring that help is effective, but also by getting close to those who suffer, so that the hand that helps is seen not as a humiliating handout, but as a sharing between brothers and sisters, fraternal community of goods." In the new imagination of mercy, the Holy Father writes about, it's not the most important to organize yourself so perfectly as to help effectively, But what's the most important is true love for a suffering person, to become his real neighbor, someone who will be able to tune in his situation, who will try to understand him and try to help him with respect and love. So the first important feature of the imagination of mercy is the ability to be neighbor to another person, for every person and in every situation in which he finds himself. To be a neighbor, that is to be close, to come closer. Look at the core of these words. Close, closer. In Polish language, these words have the same core with the word neighbor. To be neighbors, that is to get closer to other people in their problems and struggles. Every person we meet is our neighbor, and in every person, Jesus comes to us. It is important that we always do it out of love for Jesus. He said, truly I say to you, as you did it to one of the least of these my brethren, you did to me. To be a neighbor is not only to pass indifferently by a suffering man, but also to come closer to him, to make him feel that he is not alone in his pain. Pope Francis said strong words during one of the general audiences. Before the suffering of so many people exhausted by hunger, violence and injustice, we cannot remain spectators. What does it mean to ignore the suffering of man? It means to ignore God. If I do not draw close to that man, that woman, that child, that elderly man or woman who are suffering, I do not draw close to God. To be honest, we must admit that we are incapable of such love on our own. That's true. The imagination of mercy is a real revolution in our lives, because we do not have it ourselves. We have the imagination of the sinner, the imagination of the egoist, the imagination of comfort, that it would be good for me, that I'd care about myself only. It's a great news that we are all weak. Why is it great? Because we all need mercy. We're in need of mercy, and we're in need of God, who wants to pour out his mercy on us. And only then we become able to pass this mercy on to others. So the creativity and charity, the imagination of mercy, is something that we get from God. Pope John Paul II also emphasizes that the way in which we help others is important, so that the hand that helps is seen not as humiliating handout, but as a sharing between brothers and sisters, fraternal community of goods. These words refer to the community of the first Christians who, as we read in the Acts of the Apostles, had everything in common. If I help another person, it is not because I have such opportunities in terms of financial, spiritual, intellectual help, but I help the person because the person is my brother and he is in need. The creativity of mercy is born of the awareness that everything I have has been given to me by God, my Father, and therefore it's not really mine, but belongs to him. So what I received from God has been given to me in order to share with others. So when we perform mercy, the deeds of mercy, we need to remember that our mercy is a part of God's mercy, is a participation in his mercy. And it is him who is the only source of mercy, and it is him who has the power to shape the creativity of mercy in us. The merciful love, which has its source in God, makes our heart extremely sensitive so that we are not able to pass by a needy person indifferently. This is the example that Jesus left for us, leaving the imagination, the creativity of mercy. It's imitating him. To be creative in mercy is to follow Jesus in his earthly life, which was mercy towards the needy. Thus, the imagination of the creativity of mercy is not some kind of one-time charity action. It's not an impulse of the heart to help someone, but it's a constant shaping of one's mind and heart, like the merciful Jesus. This is what Saint Faustina wrote in her diary. In no way do I seek perfection inquisitively, but I probe into the spirit of Jesus and fix my eyes on his deeds and summarized in the gospel. Even if I live 1,000 years, I would not exhaust what is contained there. I am learning how to be good from Jesus, from him who is goodness itself, so that I may be called a daughter of the Heavenly Father. Faustina tells us with these words how we can develop the imagination of mercy. One such way is to meditate on God's word. When reading the Gospels, we can look at Jesus, how he lived, how he behaved towards the people he met. And we can do all this when meditating the word of God. And then, in our daily life, try to act like him, asking this question as often as possible. Jesus, what would you do in my place? The Gospels give us so many examples of his creativity in mercy, of his attitude of mercy, who bent lovingly to the sick, comforted those who weep, admonished, forgave, and lovingly embraced the smallest and the abandoned. Jesus was so human, so close to every human being. He was never indifferent to the problems of the people he met. He did not reject anyone. He didn't condemn anyone. He used to sit down at the table with tax collectors and sinners. He was not waiting for them to convert in order to sit with them. All of his life and all of his gestures showed God's merciful love. Pope Francis, in the bull establishing the extraordinary jubilee of mercy, wrote, "His person is nothing but love." What moved Jesus in all of this situation was nothing other than mercy with which he read the hearts of those he encountered and responded to their deepest needs. The signs he makes above all towards sinners, towards the poor, the excluded, the sick, and the suffering are marked by mercy. Everything in him speaks of mercy. What moved Jesus in all of these situations was nothing other than mercy. This is the perfect example of how to live the creativity in charity, creativity of mercy. May every action, every word I say is to flow out of mercy. Jesus, through his humanity, told and showed us how to live. Be merciful as your Father is merciful. We are not able to do this on our own. Therefore, we need persistent and humble prayer for our hearts to change more and more like his merciful heart. This is what Saint Faustina teaches us. She prayed, "Jesus, make my heart like unto yours, or rather transform it into your own heart, that I may sense the needs of other hearts, especially those who are sad and suffering. May the rays of mercy rest in my heart." In the Bible, we also find other examples of those who dare to live by the imagination of mercy. One of them is Mary. She, who was full of the Holy Spirit and in a perfect way allowed him to develop the imagination of mercy. Let us focus on the moment of after her meeting with God, after her prayers and listening to God and asking how does he see it, how is it supposed to happen, Mary says yes to God and sets out in haste to Ein Karim to help, to show mercy. Meeting with God, a word she heard from God pushes her out of her own home, out of her daily affairs, to help Elizabeth. So inspires her to act. Maria hears about Elizabeth and imagines that if she finds herself in such situation, she probably needs help. But not only that, it is not only about material and physical help. We know well that Mary is carrying Jesus, who was conceived in her womb by the power of the Holy Spirit. So she goes, enters Elizabeth's house and greets her, Shalom, peace to you. And then the Holy Spirit fills Elizabeth. You may wonder, how is it possible? She enters and says, good morning. And by these simple words, the Holy Spirit comes and works in Elizabeth. How does it happen? How is it possible? It's possible because Mary goes where the Holy Spirit sends her. And it is Him who works through her. He goes and she goes and she does whatever He wants from her. Wouldn't you like it to be the same in your life? You go somewhere, you meet someone, and your presence, the words you say, bring the presence of God, bring the presence and peace of the Holy Spirit, His love and comfort. It is possible. Maybe you will think that in Mary's life, yes, it was possible because she was fulfilled with the Spirit. But me? It is possible also in your life and in my life. But it is only possible when we trust God. The Holy Spirit can use us when we trust Him. When we humbly acknowledge our sinfulness and weakness, and when we accept His merciful love, and when Jesus, who died and rose for us, when we proclaim Him the only Savior and Lord of our lives, this is when we put ourselves at God's disposal, like Mary. And this is when He can do great things through us, even if we don't see this. Maybe it's even better that we don't see what He does through us. But sometimes God shows it to us so that we could give testimony of His power and mercy and to strengthen our faith. I remember when I went to evangelize openly somewhere, and there was a man who was sharing about his meeting with Jesus, that the meeting changed his life. But at the same time, the life changed itself in a way that he lost his job, he lost most of his friends, he lost the relationship with his daughter, but he didn't want to give up on God. But the conversation we had ended with a prayer where he invited Jesus to all the difficulties he suffered from. And the following day, or a couple of days later, because the evangelization lasted for a couple of days, saw that person again. He was passing me, cycling, and he stopped the bike and he said, sister, I just wanted to say thank you because all of the things we prayed for happened. And he was gone. So I don't know the details, what happened in his family, what happened in his life. But I know that God is good and He wants to pour out His graces and His mercy upon everyone. And sometimes He gives us this confirmation, the evidence that our prayer is effective, so that our faith can be stronger. Mary allowed the Holy Spirit to lead her. When God comes to her, he reveals to her the mission she is to fulfill in her life, that she's going to be the mother of the Son of God. Someone once said that there are two most important days in our life: the day you were born and the day where you found out why. Do you know what you are in this world for? What is the mission that God is entrusting to you? Mary accepted God's will. She said, "Fiat, I trust in you." But she didn't stop there. She did not remain passive. She asked more questions. How will it happen? This is extremely important also in our lives, also in the context of the creativity of mercy. Ask God not only what to do, but how. You want to be an apostle of God's mercy? Do mercy. But do you ask the Holy Spirit how to perform mercy and where to perform mercy? Do you allow the Holy Spirit to broaden the horizons of your imagination, your creativity, so that it becomes more and more God-like, the creativity of mercy? Let me give you an example. Let us use the imagination again now to imagine the various electrical appliances in our houses. Vacuum cleaner, an iron. In order to use them, we need to know what they are and how to use them. Because if I don't use them properly, like for instance, I use the vacuum cleaner for ironing, I could also try to hoover the carpet with an iron. It's important to know what's my mission, what's my calling, and how to fulfill it, and how to pursue it, how to serve the gifts, how to use these gifts that I have received from God, how to be guided in life by the creativity of mercy. The apostles of mercy should be the masters in asking God and listening to the Holy Spirit. We need to let the Holy Spirit to lead us out of our daily routines of thinking and acting, and that we should receive new explanation of what it means to become merciful. The Holy Spirit exceeds our way of thinking, exceeds our imagination. And if we are open to this way of His action, we are going to develop the real creativity of mercy. But we need to always prepare for the change in our life. The Holy Spirit is the master of the creativity of mercy. For instance, as He gives us the best computer to use our creativity, but we prefer to use the typing machine. But why? What for? We have a tool that is of the best quality. Jesus said that we need to put the new one into the new vessel. So we need to let God surprise us with His newness. We ask the Holy Spirit now to come to our hearts with the awareness of grace. We ask you, God, to pour into our hearts new wine of love, new wine of love and mercy, so that we could listen to your voice and follow your inspirations. We ask you, Holy Spirit, so that you could shape in us the creativity of mercy. This is the clap for the Holy Spirit. There's no other person who is as creative as Him. Now, if we could share all the stories of how God acted in our life, and how he inspired us to come closer, we would discover his immense creativity. He's a master of creativity. So it's important that we let him shape our hearts in such a way that he ignites them with the most creative and creativity of mercy. If we ask what is the essence of the imagination of mercy, it is love. Not even the deeds themselves, but our inner love gaze. Looking at another person as a brother. Here, near the sanctuary, there was some tunnel, pedestrians passage, and I remember there were some homeless people spending time and sleeping there. I used to pass them and share a good word and say, may God be praised. And just one day, I remember that God invited me to convert my heart and to approach these men, to start asking more questions, to give my time to them. And one man told me his story, that he had a brother in the hospital and the brother was about to die. And this man asked me to pray for the brother, and he asked the sisters to pray for the brother. And then I answered, let us pray together, because this is your brother. Your prayer is essential. So all of the men stood up and they started to pray. And during that prayer, there was also a moment when all of them opened their hearts to Jesus and they invited Jesus to their lives. Their lives, just the way it was. This life of poverty and homelessness. When I went home, I thought, I'm more gifted than these men after the meeting, after the conversation. And I've never seen these men again later on. I thought maybe that was the moment when they decided to open their lives to Christ and the lives were transformed. I was wondering, what can I give these men, passing them? I cannot cure them. I cannot give them money. What can I give? I can give something greater. I can tell them about God's love so that I could bring them to Jesus. Sometimes we may face a difficult situation in which the other person is, and in a human way, we're helpless. We don't know how to show mercy. What is the imagination of mercy to be manifested in such a situation? Jesus spoke to Sister Faustina, write this for the many souls who are often worried because they do not have the material means with which to carry out an act of mercy. Yet spiritual mercy, which requires neither permission nor storehouses, is much more meritorious and is within the grasp of every soul. And here we tackle a topic that is very important to us, the apostles of divine mercy. The creativity of mercy should primarily be manifested in the dimension of the spirit. This is not to say that we are not to show mercy in a concrete material way, but in the form of physical help to another person. I would like to say that our mercy is to have the special dimension resulting from the charism that Sister Faustina has. And we want to live her charism more and more fully. We are called to continue her mission. And in this mission, we want to shape our hearts and ask the Holy Spirit to show us how to fulfill this mission in our daily lives. It's not simple. It is much easier to see the needs of someone who has lost a roof, who has lost his house, who is sick, who is disabled or poor. Spiritual threats are harder to see. It is more difficult to come to the aid to help someone who is internally inflicted. Saint Paul, Saint John Paul II on the Krakow Meadows in 2002 said, "We must take on loving look around ourselves if we are to be aware of the neighbor by our side who, because of the loss of work, home, the possibility to maintain his family in a decent manner and to educate his children, feels a sense of abandonment, of being lost, of distrust. This creativity and charity is needed to provide material and spiritual assistance to neglected children, to refrain from turning one's back on the boy or girl who have gotten lost in the world of addiction or crime, to give advice, consolation, spiritual support to those engaged in an internal struggle with evil. How to do it? How to fulfill our mission? Let us look at the life of Sister Faustina. God chose her to convey the messages of mercy, to remind us of his merciful love for every human being. Before she began fulfilling this mission, she first met God regularly in prayer. Experiencing his merciful love, she was learning the greatest attribute of God. Jesus himself revealed his merciful heart to her and taught her about his desires. I thirst for salvation of souls. Help me, my daughter, to save souls. Help me save sinners. And Faustina, with all her heart and all her life, committed herself to this mission. She made Jesus' desires her own. Oh, Jesus, I long for the salvation of souls, immortal souls. During Holy Mass, I was so enveloped in the great interior fire of God's love and the desire to save souls that I do not know how to express it. I feel I am all aflame. I shall fight all evil with the weapon of mercy. I am being burned up by the desire to save souls. I want souls to know your mercy." Jesus taught Sister Faustina how to save lost souls. "You will join prayers, fasts, mortifications, labors, and all sufferings to my prayer, fasting, mortifications, labors, and sufferings. And then they will have power before my Father." So this is the area of creativity. Look, it's not about great acts of mercy, great works of mercy, but about being in a union with Jesus and offering him the little things of our lives out of love, in the intention of saving souls. Faustina wrote, "Do everything with the pure intention of reparation for poor sinners. This is how I'm going to do everything. This keeps me in continual union with God, and this intention perfects my actions, because everything I do is done for immortal souls." "Our hardships and fatigue are as nothing when I think that they reconcile sinful souls with God." Looking at the life of Sister Faustina, we also see how the Holy Spirit shaped her imagination of mercy in the area of prayer. The intention to convert sinners was the indispensable part of her life. Reading her notes, we can see that such a fire of mercy was burning in her heart that she could not even contain within herself this fire. And thanks to this fire, without leaving the enclosure, she reached the ends of the world with her prayers. She wrote, "I am being burned up by the desire to save souls. I traverse the world's length and breadth and venture as far as its ultimate limits and its wildest lengths to save souls. I do this through prayer and sacrifice." If Faustina could live like that, why couldn't we, each of us, were... She lived, she acted. Where we live, we can act out of the Spirit. We too can, even through prayer and sacrifice, reach the people in need of God's mercy. Where the people who lack hope, faith, social injustice, who suffer from consumerism or moral relativism, we are sent to bring God to souls who die of lack of experience of God's love. Thanks to Sister Faustina, we have received special ways to implore God's mercy for the world, and especially for unrepentant sinners. There are forms of worship of God's mercy that you know very well. Each of them, the image of merciful Jesus with this sign of the blessing, I trust in you, the peace of mercy, the chaplet of divine mercy, the hour of mercy, all of these are wonderful and effective tools through which we can cooperate with Jesus in his mission to save the world. Sister Faustina's imagination of mercy and her desire to save souls were so great. She wrote, today in union with Jesus Christ, Redeemer of souls, I make a voluntary offering of myself for the conversion of sinners, especially for the souls who have lost hope in God's mercy. The suffering consists in my accepting with total subjection to God's will all the sufferings, fears and terrors with which sinners are filled. In return, I give them all the consolations which my soul receives from my communion with God. In a word, I offer everything for them, holy masses, holy communions, penances, mortifications, and prayers. This is the creativity in mercy. This is the way we see Faustina allowed herself to be led by God. Faustina was incredibly brave. And it was because she trusted God totally. A lot of suffering, a lot of toil was the cause of her decision. But how many favors she obtained for the souls. How many souls were saved thanks to her prayers. How much we ourselves received thanks to her. This is going to remain a secret of our hearts. This makes Faustina so close to us that we feel drawn by her example to give our lives totally for the salvation of other people. Faustina teaches us to live the creativity of mercy. In her collaboration with Jesus in the work of salvation, for the work of salvation, she manifested she was following the mystery of God's mercy. The task that Jesus entrusted her was, today I am sending you with my mercy to the people of the world. I do not want to punish aching mankind, but I desire to heal it, pressing it to my merciful heart. He repeatedly reminded her of the faithful fulfillment of this task. He said, tell sinful souls not to be afraid to approach me. Speak to them of my great mercy. You see, my merciful sinners, see how the little you wrote about him. Do what it is in your power so that the sinners may know my goodness. Jesus called her to the whole world to speak about God's mercy. And it was not only a request, but a command similar to the one in the gospel when Jesus says, go to the whole world and preach the gospel to every creature. These words are addressed to each of us. Go to the world. What kind of world? Where? She would ask. Maybe you should ask yourself, what is your world God commands you to go to? Your family, your workplace, your community, your neighbors, maybe some homeless person you pass on the streets every day, maybe someone who is uncomfortable for you, someone you don't like to be with, you find him difficult. This is the world where Jesus sends you with his mercy. Ask Jesus in your heart now, what is the world? He commands you to go to, and listen to his answer. God sends you with his mercy to this world today. The first inspiration that comes to your mind now, this is the answer. Maybe it's something you are afraid of. Maybe this is that one person you cannot forgive. The very one person you're not able to bear. You need to stir your creativity now and ask Jesus, how am I supposed to carry your mercy, Jesus, to the whole world? Faustina wrote, I understand that mercy is manifold. One can do good always and everywhere and at all times. An ardent love of God sees all around itself constant opportunities to share itself through deed, word, and prayer. These are the three areas of creativity of mercy: deed, word, and prayer. John Paul II said that mercy nowadays requires an even greater creativity. So let us ask the Holy Spirit to rekindle in our hearts this apostolic fervor, this desire to proclaim mercy. Go and proclaim. The kingdom of God, the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Go and proclaim that God is merciful, that he is near. In the world we live today, in the midst of all these uncertainties, injustice, suffering, and hardship, he is. Be apostles of his merciful and tender love. Carry God's tenderness to all mankind. This is what Pope Francis calls us to repeatedly. He said, closeness, tenderness, compassion are God's style. This also should be the style of our lives. Mercy, compassion, tenderness. Being guided by the creativity of mercy. It should be the steering wheel of our life. In conclusion, I would like to quote the words spoken by St. John Paul II in the Błonia Park in Krakow in 2002. The message of merciful love needs to resound forcefully anew. The world needs this love. The hour has come to bring Christ's message to everyone, to rulers and the oppressed, to those whose humanity and dignity seem lost in the mysterium iniquitatis. The hour has come when the message of divine mercy is able to fill hearts with love and to become the spark of new civilization, the civilization of love. What is needed today is, as I called in my apostolic letter, creativity and charity. What is needed today is a new creativity in charity. May this creativity never be lacking in the residents of Krakow and in all the people of our homeland. This is what the Pope said in Krakow. So let us never lack this imagination. All the residents of Krakow and all the people of our homeland, and may the creativity will be abundant in all the apostles of the mercy in the world. Thank you.